Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to another episode of the West Coast Jazz Hour. If I'm not mistaking, episode 33
I think
or
you're right.
yeah, I think episode 33.
Yep.
We can actually make a cheers. We would highly recommend for this episode that you will make a drink for yourself because we're going to show you lots of music that a cocktail is sort of needed with the whole scenery that we're going to create over here. But we also have to point out that Josh and I have been doing these episodes for a year and 6 days now. Woo-hoo! So
Yeah.
May 5th of 2020 was our first episode with just the two of us as well. And that turned out into a really cool first weekly hang, and now it's bi-weekly, if I'm saying that correctly.
Bi-monthly,
So
I guess.
bi-monthly, thank you. As you can see, second language still. After 6 years being in the US, it still screws me up from time to
Hey
time.
man, you've been doing a great job.
Thank you.
Very good. Oh, episode 34.
34,
I
thank
just
you. There
checked.
you go.
Yep.
There you go. So episode 34, and today we're going to do a tribute to one of the greatest composers in American jazz and American music history, the great Henry Mancini. We're going to show you lots of music from various CDs, various recordings, I should say, that he made over the years. His discography is just stunning with how much music he has written for not only his own projects, but for so many movies. And Josh is more of an expert on that territory than I am. So we'll definitely have a couple discussions with our local Mancini expert.
Thanks.
Let me actually give you some background information about Mr. Henry Mancini. He was born in Cleveland, Ohio, on April 16th, 1924, as Enrico Nicola Mancini, also known as Henry Nicola Mancini, and he passed away on June 14th, 1994. In Los Angeles. He was known as an American composer, conductor, arranger, pianist, and flautist, and he's often cited as one of the greatest composers in the history of film. He won four American Academy Awards, a Golden Globe, and 20 Grammy Awards, plus a posthumous Grammy Lifetime Achievement Award in 1995. And that's just the tip of the iceberg, a very small tip of the iceberg of what this man has done for the music history. Josh, what should we start with playing? Because I think we just should get right into the music and have some maybe some comments
Yeah.
if the viewers or listeners have some comments or whatever or something that they would love to share.
Yeah.
Go right ahead, I would say.
Well, cheers to you, Kevin, once again.
Cheers.
Raise your glasses, everyone, if you have a glass, to a
We
great
hope
year.
so. Yes,
Great
indeed.
year of discovering new music, old music, meeting some new old friends, and just exploring the rich history of West Coast jazz with you has just been so fun. And thanks all who have joined us, and just really, really thrilled to do this show with you today. This is so cool. And I was joking with Kevin that it's probably, could it end up being a two-part show because there's just so much music to explore, and history to look at with Mancini and what he did for the mu movie music and big band writing and just the West Coast scene in general in a lot of ways. So gosh, it's hard to start with pick one thing. There's too many good things, but I guess if I had to start with something, I think I might start with this swinging track from Peter Gunn. Peter Gunn was a show on television from the late 50s, 58 to 61, I think it ran. starring Craig Stevens, and one of his more popular melodies. He has so many popular melodies, as I'm sure a lot of you know. But I just, in the tradition of kind of the West Coast jazz era and looking at some of the important musicians on the West Coast scene, this is definitely an example of folks that he used that we've actually talked about quite a bit and shared some of their music on this show. So let's just, for now, we'll just get into the track and then maybe we can talk about it afterwards and who is on it. I'll just fact check and while we're listening, as maybe you want to as well, Kevin, but you might know some of these musicians, everybody. But let's just check out a little underscore. This is not the main theme from Peter Gunn, but it's a cue from the show, and it's called Sort of Blue, Sort of Blue. So thanks for joining us, and some music from the late 50s from Henry Mancini on the show Peter Gunn.
Enjoy.
Pretty swinging, kind of
Very cool.
a cocktail vibe on that one for sure.
Yes, very
Yeah,
much so.
that was Sort of Blue from the music from Peter Gunn. And from what I can see here, Kevin, maybe you can correct me. This is came out in 1959, right after the show had started. And I think that was Ted Nash on alto, Ronnie Lang on barry sax, Raleigh Bundock on bass, the great Jack Sperling on drums, Johnny Williams on piano, the great film composer Johnny Williams, Dick Nash and Milt Bernhardt sharing the trombone duty. I probably was Dick soloing on that one, I would assume. Sounded
Well,
like it.
Dick is here, so
Dick, was that you? Hey, Dick. I'm glad you're here. Hey, everybody. Mancini's favorite trombone player, who was played on so many recordings of Hank Mancini's, is here. He was a guest on our show some episodes ago, but we're lucky to have him here, and maybe he'll chime in with some Mancini trivia. Pete Candoli on trumpet and Larry Bunker on the vibes. Great band. Just swinging, you know. feels so good, just nice and light to kick us off. Any thoughts on that track, Kevin?
I just thought about a couple things. I'm seeing on Wikipedia that that's the full I see the full lineup of the entire recording. Sounded like Alvin Stoller on this track to me.
Oh, not Jack.
No, Jack sounds to me a little lighter actually. He has a lighter touch on the ride cymbal, and Alvin has more of a heavier touch, and I would have heard it if it was Shelly, because Shelly has also a completely different sound. So I think this is Alvin
Alvin.
on
Okay.
this
I
track.
stand corrected, and maybe Dick knows too.
The thing that's so cool about this track is which might be also a thing that's at the same time one of the, how should I call it, one of the main one of the main recognizable things of Mancini's music is that it's very thematic. You have this melody that repeats a couple of times, and then there's a development of it solo, and then it goes actually to another section of a melody that's also actually like very catchy. And that's one of the things that is so instantly recognizable on about Mancini's music. And you know, the music of Mancini is so powerful that you know the musicians, I have the impression that the musicians are really, who are soloing on this track, are really just floating on the music. Like they're not really, you know, like playing all of these like hip chops or, you know, like whatever, but they're really riding along with this like cool vibe that Mancini created with this piece and with his entire repertoire. So it's a thing that made me think back of what Vince Mendoza said about his way of working with musicians. And we know that from Henry Mancini as well, that he worked with a regular group of musicians, which he treated also really great. That shows you kind of also that this man chose his musicians based on what he wanted for his music. And you know, like Dick, if you're hearing this, like please chime in, because I might be wrong as well, and I would love it that I would be stand corrected by you. But that's kind of the educated guess that I'm making for all of his music, basically.
I totally agree. I mean, the melodies, and he talks about these in some interviews. Like I was telling you before the show, and folks watching at home, you can just YouTube Henry Mancini interviews and listen to him talk about his music and the importance of melody and some of his favorite composers that inspired him. He actually cites Victor Young as one of his tops, who was a workhorse in Hollywood who scored like hundreds of films. Who was also unabashedly melodic with his choices. And now some of course, Mancini and Victor Young's songs are some of the more standard fare for jazz musicians because they have such fantastic melodies. They're thematic, they last, and the recordings, you're right, Kevin, the recordings that are represented so well by the people that recorded them, including the great Al Schmidt, who I think worked on this album. Who just passed, a little tribute to our fallen music comrade,
Yes,
Al
indeed.
Schmidt, the great recording engineer, who just passed away, who did so many things. Like I said on a previous show, I think I got to record with him a couple times, and he was a gentleman. So very, very cool that he got to do it. Anyway,
Cheers to you, Al.
Al, and the and his legacy. But you're right, the musicians that Mancini chose to help bring his music to life, so very important. Kind of in the same, in some ways, the same cloth as Count Basie and Ellington and some of the big bands of the day, Dorsey and Miller and Artie Shaw. You know, the strength in numbers and greater than the whole, greater than the sum of its parts kind of idea. So great section players and great soloists like Mr. Nash and the Cannoli brothers, and just incredible. So yeah, I agree. Melody, 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 melody. It's just Dick says, so far you're not wrong. Great.
That's great.
I love it. So good to have you here, Dick. Wow. You want to take us on another musical Mancini journey? Okay.
Let
Where are
me
we going
see
next?
what I will pick.
And Dick, if you have anything you want us to play, I have one thing picked out for you or that features you, but if there's something you really love, let us know, please, and we'll see if we can find it.
Well, why don't I go just down the list, because we've kind of made a chronological list. The next album that's on the list for this is the Mancini Touch, and I didn't know about this record, or I heard about this recording, but I haven't really checked it out until yesterday for the show, because I did
Yes.
a bunch of Mancini listening.
Mm-hmm.
I think the title is also pretty cool, because I mean, music can touch people, but Mancini also has like a certain touch with his music. It's very cool. Sometimes it's very majestic, but it can also be very small and kind of like movie-esque, that it's kind of enticing to like a very thrillery type of scene, or maybe more to like a romantic type of scene. And this is kind of what I thought, which is actually a ballad of this album, mostly for lovers. And I just like it just hit me in the face how much I liked this piece and this melody. So I'm going
Great.
to share my sound with you real quick and show you from the album The Mancini Touch, mostly for lovers.
Thank you. just beautiful.
Yeah, very, very, just very, very pretty. And as I said, you, to me, it sort of created like a scene, you know, like for everybody, it's something different, but it created like this nice scene of like one of those like cool romantic American movies from like the late 50s or early 60s, something like that. Many of the same people that you just mentioned played on this recording. John Williams is on piano. We heard a little bit of the great Bob Bain on guitar.
Worked with him a lot.
Harry Klee, Ronnie Lang, Ted Nash on saxophone. That was Vic Feldman on vibraphone. Carl Dakarski, Johnny Halliburton, Dick Nash, Jimmy Pretty on trombone. Trumpets and that's wrong on the description. Where are the trumpets? There are
Was
no
that Shelley on
trumpets.
drums?
That's Shelley. Yeah,
Sounded like
that's Shelley
him.
on drums.
Great.
It just says John Kay, Vince DeRosa, John Gross, Richard Parisi, and Claude Cherry on horns. So this, I'm not completely sure, but this might be an album without trumpets. Because I'm seeing this on Wikipedia.
Maybe. Maybe Dick
But
knows. Just ask Dick.
The thing though, what spring or what stands out in this recording is his incredible way of writing for strings. And as soon as the that part comes out where the trombones and the French horns are playing together, how like lush it is. That's one of his key things, how he could
Classic.
write for French horn together with brass.
Yeah, actually, speaking of that, this was my Bible for all of college. My composer teacher, the great John Prince, who was the head of Long Beach State Music Department, gave me this copy. This is his copy before he passed, and he said, "This is pretty much all you'll need to ever know for writing for strings and big band."
Yeah, I can
And it's laid
imagine.
out incredibly. Unfortunately, the record that came in here is missing. It's supposed to be a little like a 7-inch in there, so that's not here. But it's a wonderful book. And he, speaking of his writing, he lays it out very clearly and how he kind of comes up with some of his sounds, like you're saying, his the lush writing between the horns and the strings, very unique, and also in some ways simple, but clean and clear and executed well and recorded well, all the pieces of the puzzle like coming together, you know. But yeah, that's great. And I what I like that what you picked about that track, and even the one I picked, we're kind of looking at maybe some lesser known cuts from Mancini's library. And we can definitely play some of the hits, you know, Days of Wine and Roses and Moon River, but I figure most people probably know those. So this is, yeah, kind of our slant at West Coast Jazz Hour anyway, is to kind of uncover maybe some lesser known things or gems or, so I appreciate you sharing that cut from the Mancini Touch is the record, right?
The Mancini Touch, yeah. The cover of it is great because it has like this it's a portrait of Mancini, but then he's holding like a stick with little ties on it, and then he controls basically a couple which is dancing under him, and it looks like very silky,
Great
and you
cover.
know, yeah. So the I mean, for all of the music that we're playing today, we would recommend that to our listeners to check that out for sure. For the West Coast Jazz Hour cocktail hour also. Cheers,
Celebrating 1 year,
everybody.
everybody, 1 year of
Yes.
the show that Kevin had the idea of coming up with. Thanks for joining us, everybody. I see Gina Kronstadt's here, the wonderful vocalist. She says, "I got to work with Hank and sit next to him as he played piano, and it was the first time I realized how much a piano can sing, probably around 1980. How cool
Wow.
is that? Wow, Gina. So great. Thanks for sharing that."
Yeah, and Douglas
Hey,
Flaker
Douglas.
says, an album without trumpets, that's like a day without sunshine.
Nice.
That's good. Somebody loves trumpets, I guess.
Yeah. I just
Well,
brought my trumpet out again, Douglas. I'm practicing again, so watch out, you know.
oh boy.
Yeah, this is new. There's a new boy in town here. No, just kidding. Completely kidding. I'm a hack. I'm a
Yeah.
marching band trumpet player in my high school years, and that's about it.
Right, right,
Yeah.
right.
Hey Marty, thanks for joining us. Great DJ. Marty Friedman's here. Great. Cool. Shall
And thank
we?
you for congratulating us.
Yeah.
Yeah,
Thanks, Marty.
let's
Move
continue
on.
with something else. Yeah.
Great. I love this movie. We can't play Mancini without playing a little bit of his film music
Yeah, you
because
know a whole lot of
there's
stuff
just
about
too
that.
much. I think I do, but I'm always discovering scores that I never knew he did. Just recently I didn't even realize he scored this Audrey Hepburn film that I it is great with Alan Arkin and what's the Wait Until Dark. Kind of a creepy movie about these burglars who bother Audrey Hepburn, who's a blind woman, and Mancini score. He also scored Touch of Evil by Orson Welles, which is a fantastic film, and some things that aren't quite as romantic. Hatari was another movie he did.
Oh yeah.
Oklahoma Crude, I believe. So he really made the rounds. He was on staff at Universal for about 6 years, and in a couple interviews, he talks about the sound of the room there, but also at Fox, and how the sound of a room really makes something come together. And of course, a lot of this music was also recorded at RCA, and a testament to, again, the engineers and the natural sounding rooms that captured these fantastic musicians and performances. But this film I love. It's called Mr. Hobbs Takes a Vacation.
Oh yeah.
Have you seen it?
No, I haven't, but I know that title.
It's fun. It's Jimmy Stewart and Maureen O'Hara, 1962. It's a great, totally fun movie. And the music by Henry Mancini. And let's just hear the main title here because it's pretty swinging. I think you'll agree. So here we go. Main title from Mr. Hobbs Takes a Vacation by Henry Mancini.
Thank you.
Yep. Tasty.
The first couple bars of that piece that reminds me like of a movie that Fred Astaire or Gene Kelly could have,
Right?
be featured in, like a kind of like dance, tune.
Right. Think it was Sperling on drums?
This sounds like Shelley.
Shelley. Sometimes I can't tell the difference between Sperling and Shelley on certain fills, and just the way they feel it.
Shelley has there. I mean, there are Sperling isms and there are Shelley man
Sure.
isms. Again, for this recording, I hear it because of Shelley's ride cymbal.
That give it
It's
away. I'm not the expert there, so thankfully you are.
Sperling has a little bit. It's funny because Sperling has a little bit of a sound that's in between Alvin and Shelley. Like Shelley can sound so light as a feather. In that tune that we just played, mostly for lovers, he was playing just brushes. But the only guy who can pull it off to basically crash the hi-hat like that with your left foot. The only guy who can do that tastefully is Shelly Manne, because if I would do it or anybody else would do it, it would sound like a freaking marching band, like that, but the interesting thing is with Shelly is that he's always the, in my opinion, the lighter sounding drummer of on these recordings. Alvin is always a little bit more on the heavier side, and Sperling is kind of like in between Shelley and Alvin, if I when I'm listening to it, and very particular types of sounds too. Yeah, they're more. I would say that Shelley and Sperling are a little bit more out there with their sounds, and Alvin always is a little bit more. I would say like all round and. Adjusts a little more, but with Shelly you like nowadays I can pick Shelly out of it like instantly. I couldn't do that last year, I can tell you.
Well, you've been listening well. I mean, on the Library of Congress website, I'm seeing the listing of personnel. Herb Alpert is cited as playing on this record.
Oh wow.
And Dick Nash, Vince DeRosa, John Gross, a lot of the same cats, Ted Nash, Plas Johnson, Gene Cipriano, former West Coast Jazz Hour guest, the great Bob Bain, Barney Kessel, Howard Roberts, Al Viola, all play guitar.
Wow, that's some insane guitar
A
players.
lot of guitar, and Al Hendrickson too. And Mike Rubin on bass, not familiar. Larry Bunker, Chuck Flores, and Shelly Manne, drums and percussion.
That
So probably
sounded definitely.
vibes, Larry Bunker.
It was always that's always the thing also with Larry, and for next month we're going to do a super fun Larry Bunker tribute
Yeah,
because he
exactly.
was so underrated as a drummer, but I really have to look for recordings with Larry where he's actually playing drums, where he's playing vibes, no problem, but like where he's playing drums in a big band setting like this. Of course he did a lot of things with Bill Evans, but it's pretty hard to find good stuff with Larry on it. Yeah, but drummer wise, he's, in my opinion, one of the most unrecognized drummers out there. While he is such a bad cat, so incredible what that guy
Yes.
was doing on drums. And this reminds me of the episode that we did with Jeff Hamilton, where he speaks about Larry, and that he asked Larry how he came up with all of these ideas, and Larry just said like, "Oh, I just play drums. I don't know where it's coming from." And then to think that he was an amazing orchestral percussionist, also like one of the most in-demand orchestral percussionists in the history of LA jazz. So, yeah,
That's
lots.
going to be a fun show.
Yeah, that
Looking
should be
forward to
very
that.
fun with a couple of cool guests as a panel. So stay tuned for that, folks.
Nice. Very cool. Well, so there was a little film music, maybe lesser known Mancini score from Mr. Hobbs Takes a Vacation. Where are we going next, Kev?
Let's see what's on the list. Oh, this is a cool thing. So, the next thing that's at least on my list is a tune from The Blues and the Beat, which is an album that he made in 1960. And I knew of this recording, but a couple of weeks ago I had the opportunity to go to Daphne Kelly, who is Frank Capra's daughter. And she lives in the in Frank's old house, and I got the opportunity to take a peek in Frank Capra's record collection, and I found this record in there, but it was completely sealed, and it was acquired in the 60s, but never played, wrapped in plastic, and I was mind blown because that record, I couldn't see what kind of pressing it was, but regardless, it's worth a lot of money because it's never played, it's sealed. But I was able to look on the liner notes for a little bit, and the liner notes looked really, really cool. And this might be either Sperling, I think this is an album where Sperling is actually playing drums on. And I've listened to it a little bit because I actually want to get it on vinyl and then wait till I get it on vinyl and then listening to it. But I listened to a couple tunes, and this is the first tune of that record that I'm going to play for you. And it's called Tippin' In. Here we go. Tipping in on The Blues and the Beat.
1960.
Thank you.
That's great. I don't know this record as well. I don't have it. I've heard
It's
it,
on
but
my it's on my want list, but
yep.
we just heard to or we just heard from the great Johnny Williams on piano. I believe that was Ronnie Lang on alto. Bob Bain is again on guitar, Sperling on drums, Roland Bundock on bass. We heard, I think we heard both of Vic Feldman and Larry Bunker on vibes, because I heard different sounding vibraphones. Sip, Harry Klee, Ronnie Lang, Ted Nash, and Wilbur Schwartz are the woodwinds. Conrad Gatso, Frank Beach, Graham Young, Pete Candoli, trumpet, and then the same trombone section as on mostly on Mostly for Lovers almost. Dick Nash, Jimmy Pretty, John Halliburton, and Carl Dekarski on trombone, and then George Price, Herbin Liebau, John Gross, Richard Parisi, Sinclair Lott, and Vince DeRosa on French horn. And the engineer for this production was the great Al Schmidt as well. So again, just a beautiful recording, and it does you can definitely hear, like, it does honor to the name of the album, the blues and the beat. So there's a lot of blues stuff in here. They play also a couple of standards on this album, such as Misty, Mood Indigo, All Right, Okay, You Win, Sing 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 even. So it's a cool record that I know of that I need to get ASAP. A thing that we haven't touched upon just yet is that this is also another great example of how he writes for a French horn together with the brass, but also how he writes for flute. Because that was a thing that Vince also pointed out when we listened to, I think, a tune off of Uniquely Mancini, that his flute writing is just incredible and so recognizable for Mancini,
Sure is.
with alto flutes, also these thick voicings for flute.
Sorry, I didn't
So
mean to
no, no
distract you.
worry.
I think I have something to show with flutes next.
Dick says that was his brother on alto playing the solo. Yeah, he thinks that's the case. I stand corrected.
Our first correction. Thank you, Mr. Nash. Go to the
Yeah,
source.
exactly.
It's so
Exactly.
great to have you here once again and listening to this with you. So,
Nice trip down memory lane for you, I would say.
let's listen to some touching on your comment about the flutes and how well he
Yeah.
wrote for not only brass but woodwinds. This record, Our Man in Hollywood, Henry Mancini, I just adore. I think it's just completely swinging. And not every song is from Mancini's pen, it is his arranging, but the track I'd like to play is an Elmer Bernstein composition, another great composer, one of my favorites, who
Yep.
they were working, of course, at the same time, and so many great scores from Elmer. And this is from I believe it's a TV show. I don't know if it was a. I think it's a TV show. Walk on the Wild Side is the name of the track. Maybe someone can clarify. I think it's a show, not a film. But you'll hear four bass flutes on this track. And Plas Johnson's here, and some others I'll have to look up, but probably a lot of the same folks we've been naming, the Mancini stable, the Mancini stable of actors. So this is Walk on the Wild Side, 1963 recording, Our Man in Hollywood, Henry Mancini. And thanks everyone for being here. We're having a fun time talking and listening to music of the great, great Henry Mancini. Oh, I think it was a movie. Thanks, Dick and Roland. Thank you. Haven't seen it yet. I got homework to do. Walk on the Wild Side. Here we go.
Thank you.
swinging. And that was the Elmer Bernstein theme from the film Walk on the Wild Side, which thank you, Marty. You chimed in with a little bit of trivia there. Nominated for Academy Award, Best Music, Elmer Bernstein Composer, Mac David Lyricist. Also a song by Lou Reed. Very cool. That was Plaz Johnson, the soloist, of course, from most people know the Pink Panther theme, also by Mancini, but he recorded on many, many films of Mancini's and others. Shelley on drums, I believe. Yeah. I'm learning.
Yeah, this is true.
Yeah. And probably Bob Bain and Ted. Yeah. and
no, I at least Wikipedia says Lorindo Almeida.
Oh, Lorindo Almeida. Oh.
Yeah. And Bob. Bob is also credited, actually. Oh, so I'm sure that Bob is on this one because Lorindo was really the Brazilian guitar player.
Right.
So for that kind of bluesy stuff, I'm sure that's
right.
Bob.
Right. And Jimmy Rolls on piano, at least listed here. That's pretty great. The great Jimmy Rolls. Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's a little continuing your comment of his great flute writing, well, great writing all around, but how he chose to score them and use them melodically and build the arrangement from beginning to end and how the strings kind of swell and just classic Mancini treatment of another great composer's melody.
Yeah, it has a beautiful arc to it, starting from small and then going into a majestic, you know, like ending kind of. Yeah, I forgot to mention also about the blues and the beat. It won the Grammy for Best Large Ensemble in 1961, actually, that previous recording.
Fantastic. Thanks for sharing that. He won many Grammys, 20 or so.
20. Yeah. 20 in total and won posthumously, like the Grammy Lifetime Award.
Incredible.
1 year after he passed.
What a career.
Yeah, yeah, and you showed actually something to me earlier this week of a letter from what was it, ASCAP or ASMAC?
It was ASCAP, yeah.
Yeah.
American Society of Composers and Performers, I think.
Yeah.
Anyway, for those who don't know what ASCAP is, it's a music rights and royalty kind of organization. Yeah, that Kevin's talking about.
Yeah. So he got declined from being a member of that organization. That's kind of wild.
Yeah. They didn't think, what was it? It was like they didn't think his music was going to sell enough or be successful enough, or we don't see a reason to have you around. Then he turned around and got like a few Academy Awards right after that or something.
Yeah. It was a letter from like 1957 and then 58 or 59, he started to hit it, or probably already before that.
Right.
Because Discogs, where do I have my Discogs? Discogs credits him for 5,698 items for his writing and arranging, which is insane.
Yeah.
And the earliest credit that is given on Discogs is something for Columbia Records from 1953, Victor Young and his singing strings, Geraldine and Love Theme from the Glenn Miller Story. That's the very first thing that he's credited for.
Glenn Miller Story, which is we'll play that featured track that features Dick Nash and maybe in a little bit afterwards.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
I don't know that.
So beautiful.
I'll go a little bit off of the chronological path over here because I have one of my favorite Mancini records over here, Mancini 67, and this is a record that I got to know through my teacher Peter Erskine at USC when I was there, and the thing that caught me about this recording is that the rhythm section is formed by Ray Brown and Jack Sperling. And I didn't really have like a good sense at the time who Jack Sperling was, but I definitely knew who Ray Brown was. I was like, oh, I gotta check this out. And this recording is full of world-class musicians, Jimmy Rolls bopping, Ray Brown, Jack Sperling. Percussion is Milt Holland, Larry Bunker, or Vic Feldman. And then the woodwinds are just the usual suspects: Ronnie Lane, Ted Nash, Gene Cipriano, Harry Klee, Plas Johnson, French horns, Vince DeRosa, Dick Parisi, John Cave, and Arthur Mabe. Trombones, there he is again, Dick Nash, Jimmy Pretty, John Halliburton, George Roberts, or Carl Dakarski for a bass trombone. And then Al Porcino, Ray Trescari, Pete Condoli, Bud Brisbois, or Jack Sheldon, and Frank Beach, or Maurice Harris. So you got yourself a fine lineup of super cool musicians. And the track that I want to play for you guys is Stockholm Sweetening, which is not a Mancini composition. It's a composition of Quincy Jones. And I know that those two had a lot of admiration for each other. I think that Quincy Jones was also being taken, that Mancini took Quincy under his mantle to get Quincy some movie writing over here when Quincy moved to Los Angeles. And I also know that Quincy Jones made his own record of music from Henry Mancini. So I can strongly recommend that recording because it's also super cool. But let's take a listen to Stockholm Sweetening off of Mancini 67, which is also an album that was recorded in 67. Yes, recorded or at least published, definitely published in 67. So here we go, Stockholm Sweetening.
Great. Our great woodwind writing.
That's right.
Thank you. Swinging.
Yeah.
Ugh.
Well, when you have Ray Brown in the rhythm section, then you can't go wrong.
That was so good with Jack Sperling. Did they do anything else together?
Yeah, that's actually a good question that you're putting out there.
Huh.
I have a record here. If I can have a minute, then I can grab it in a minute.
Yeah.
There's a Bob Florence record that's called Pet Sounds. Yeah, Pet Sounds. All kinds of jazz arrangements of Petula Clark
Oh.
songs, which has Sperling and Ray
Oh,
Brown
I
on
gotta
it
get
too.
that. Oh,
Yeah, it's
cool.
really, really, really
I
good. And
bet.
I think that's the only, don't quote me on this, but it might be the only recording that Sperling made with Bob Florence,
Oh,
because Florence used to work with Nick Cerulli or
Right.
Frank Capp a lot. So yeah, this
Wow.
that's kind of like a one-off
Yeah.
one-off thing, having the
That's great.
Mancini rhythm section. Yeah, it's a
Nice, dude.
amazing recording, really healing.
Wow. Cool. Thanks for sharing that.
Yeah.
Karen asking who. Hey, Karen Hammack. Thanks for being here. Who's playing flute? Was it Ronnie Lang on that?
It could
Or
be.
Sip?
It
Maybe.
could be either one of those. It doesn't really say.
Oh.
Now let me see. Well, it does say here,
Maybe
Stockholm
Dick knows.
Sweeping.
Dick
No, Ronnie
Nash?
Lang. It's
It's
it says
Ronnie.
here in the it says here in the liner notes.
Oh,
Yeah.
cool. That's great. I
This.
love when vinyl actually tells you not only who's playing, but who's on
Right.
certain tracks. Because oftentimes,
Exactly.
actually, a lot of my Mancini records didn't even list the personnel. Thankfully,
Yeah.
websites like Discogs or Library of Congress or Allmusic will tell you whether it's right or not is the question.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Everything is on here.
On that
All
one,
of the
yeah.
information. Yeah. And
That's
it says,
fantastic.
this was composed by Quincy Jones, another of the great contemporary writers.
Yeah.
He and Hank belong to a very exclusive mutual admiration society. Note the opening passage featuring three alto flutes and two bass flutes, and the flute solo is by Ronnie Lang. The vibes work here is by Victor Feltman.
Whew.
End quote.
Just can you imagine just I mean we've kind of in a way, Kevin, been going down this dreamlike journey together of what it must have been like in the 50s and 60s, long before we were born.
Oh yeah.
Well,
Oh yeah.
definitely long before you were born.
Most definitely.
yeah, but just the top players, and there's of course still fantastic players in Los Angeles, not a question about that,
Yeah.
but the heyday not only of musicians getting together with for gigs, but the sessions and the composers and these directors that use these composers that utilize these musicians, and their talents, just incredible. What a rich time in recording history. Every time
Yeah.
we go down this road, I'm just reminded of how rich and amazing it must have been.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. And Sip is still around of that section.
Yep.
Ronnie Lang is still with us, and Plas Johnson is also with us still.
Yeah, fantastic.
That's I've been in touch with Ronnie Lang once before, and pretty sure that at some point we'll get him on the
Oh,
show.
that would be great.
Yeah. He's also a
Yes.
person who's done a lot of different things and is very humble about how much he actually did. Yeah, there's a really cool interview actually with Ronnie Lang. It's about 30 minutes long, but
Oh.
he explains how he got in the recording scene. And why he was called so many times, because he was really good. He had a really good set of ears, but he was really good at impersonating different players. So if they would say like, "Hey, can you play this as Charlie Parker?" He would, like mess around and sound almost exactly like Charlie Parker. Or they said like, if you kind of like a modern or like an old school modern version of a West Coast musician, what we talked about with Alan Kaplan, for example. Like if you're on a recording session and you have to sound like a musician who's from the 30s or the 40s or the 50s,
Right.
Ronnie was doing that, but then back in the late 50s, early 60s,
Wow.
that's why he got so many calls for like film scores and all of that stuff. So he was very very good at adapting himself into a certain role. He didn't make that many jazz recordings of his own. I have a recording here that features him on a couple tunes with the Les Brown Band, which is a really killing recording that features Ronnie Lang and Frank Rosalino and Don Fagerquist and
Oof.
somebody else as well.
Good
And
band.
they're all in solo
Yeah.
roles, so they're
Yeah.
getting a spotlight by Les, and
Wow,
it's
yeah.
also a really killing recording.
Yeah. Well, that's cool. Wow. You're sharing some good ones. That's awesome. Yeah. Mancini talks about that in one of those interviews, about getting the players he wants, but also needing to hire specialty players, players that can do all kinds of things, not just on different instruments, but like you said, Ronnie Lang and his talent to kind of be a chameleon. The interviewer was asking if he always had the same players every time, and he said, "Well, if I had my druthers, I would, but sometimes I need, certain things." So, just great. I love that lore of film music history in Hollywood back then. That's
And
great.
remembering back on John Clayton's episode a little while ago, that John Clayton got the gig with
Oh,
Mancini
yes.
through Ray Brown,
Right.
actually, because Ray
Right.
brought JC over to a session of Mancini, and not long after, JC started working with Henry Mancini as well.
Right.
So there's a lot of
Connections.
connections here.
Love it. Love it. Should we move on to something else? Keep going here. Time is flying. There's too much material, everybody. We're seeing some comments here. Hey, Mark Isbell, thanks for being here, man. He saw me put up the soundtrack to The Party, one of my favorite Blake Edwards films. Of course, Henry Mancini had a wonderful tenure of seven Pink Panther films and The Party as well. And yeah, you can find a lot of these soundtracks, of course, now on YouTube, Spotify. In fact, I just saw on YouTube the whole Party soundtrack's up there. So probably won't get to it today. There's just not enough time and too much music to get through. But it is a fun one. And of course, I'm a big Peter Sellers fan. And Mancini was talking about that in one of the interviews, actually, scoring how much to score for comedies because he was concerned that the music would overtake the genius of someone like Peter Sellers. So he was very cautious about how much he used music. Of course, that was in conjunction with Blake Edwards, the director, working with him on it. But he said, "I don't need to do much or zero music sometimes when Peter Sellers is on camera, because he's just fills up so much of what's happening. You don't really need a lot." And there's only a few moments, he says, in Pink Panther films where there's music underneath what Peter Sellers is doing. It's kind of around
That's
him,
interesting.
not really happening with him. So a little insight into Mancini's genius.
Dick Nash is saying it was a wonderful time, and we're so happy to be bringing enjoyment to a new generation. Hank was the greatest. P.S. If you hear the current Walgreens ad, that's something for Kat from Be Breakfast at Tiffany's.
Wow. That's great, Dick. Thank you. Yeah, I mean, there is a new generation of people that are becoming interested in this music. Kevin and I are definitely on board with that, and I know that there's a lot of young people who are discovering some of these beautiful melodies and these great performances for the first time. To me, it's new music. If I haven't heard it, just because it was recorded 50, 60 years ago, doesn't matter to me. It's still beautiful, and I learned so much from talking about it with Kevin and listening to it, and it's just the best.
That brings me actually to a question for you, actually, Josh, because I mentioned this to you that I listened to your Discoveries recording last weekend, and The Sky Remains.
Thank you.
With your Discovery Project ensemble, which is a larger ensemble. To what extent was Henry Mancini an influence on that music, and also the instrumentation for your Discovery group?
Yeah.
Was it? Is that the case, or am I talking like blah, 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 or?
No, not at all. It's funny you mentioned that. And thank you, by the way, for listening to, and plugging my records.
Oh, you're very welcome.
They're available at Jut. No, just kidding. What I'd say as far as influence of Mancini on my music is melody and the thematic use of melody and creating a memorable record, a memorable musical experience, even if it's not necessarily tied to a film. In the case of Discovery Project, when we do it live, there are visuals, but the whole point of it too is that the music can live on a record outside of the experience that you have in person. But definitely melody and his way of each song, whether it genre, coalesces into the same genre, it doesn't really matter to me if it's all under the same umbrella of Mancini or Nelson, whatever. It has a sound, and I'm not interested necessarily on a recording to make every song sound the same. I want to have a story, and there's a theme, and that kind of direction in it. So you're definitely right. I mean, instrumentation. For sure, a little bit. I think I was probably listening to more when I came up with the original Discoveries record. I was really into Herbie Hancock's late 60s, early 70s records, like Speak Like a Child and The Prisoner. They were really important
Oof.
recordings to me.
Oh my
And when I
God.
heard them, I just was completely just blown away. The Mancini stuff that I started checking out, a lot like Quincy Jones' music, was film-based. At the beginning, and actually, there's still some you're playing some now that I know less or not necessarily tied to a film, so of course, Breakfast at Tiffany's, Two for the Road, The Party, all the Pink Panther films, Touch of Evil, all these great films. That's where I was like, wow, Mancini's like he's one of these geniuses. And also, my grandfather, who was a big influence on me, Pete Irwin, he adored Mancini, and some of the records I have, are from his collection. And he also loved Leonard Bernstein and Andre Previn. And so my grandfather was probably playing a lot of that around the house. And I was like, as a young kid, checking it out and going, wow. So whether I knew it or not, maybe it was just like coming in, from different avenues like that. It's always nice when you have a family member who's into it and shares their love and passion with you. And that definitely lit a fire under me. And then at Long Beach State, where I got my bachelor's, and I was talking about the Sounds and Scores book, John Prince was the director there, and again, another person that shares their love of the music. And he said, "Man, get Sounds and Scores, Henry Mancini. Actually, here's my book." And he just gave it to me. And I studied that, and that probably had some influence because that was when I was 18, 19 years old. So a myriad of ways that Mancini has kind of shaped things. And then, the Henry Mancini Institute. It was a short-lived organization. I believe it was on the campus of UCLA in the late 90s, mid-late 90s. My friend Megan went to school, studied there, and she was talking about all the people she met and the legacy of Mancini, and Greg Field was involved, and Monica and Ginny Mancini. So I started learning about him more through other people, and it might have actually been on the campus of Long Beach State for a minute too. So it was just around, especially in the 90s, and he had only like passed not that long before that. What, 94 or something
He
he
passed in
died?
94,
Yeah. So I went to college in 1996. So it was his legacy was still, you could feel his presence still on the scene when I was just getting started.
Nice. That's cool. I definitely hear that what you're saying about your sense of melody is that the tunes on Discoveries and Sky Remains, that the melodies are really strong and
Oh, thanks.
Sort of like, like that you only have to hear them once and they're at least in my head. So, that's, like a little earbug, so to speak.
Yeah.
So I can hear
Thanks.
that. I can hear that, like the motivic development of at my Macrendon, for
Yeah,
example.
oh,
That's
thanks.
something. Yeah, for sure. So it makes a lot of sense. I was wondering about that.
Thank you. Speaking of melody, this is one that I love of Mancini's, and it's from a record of Sarah Vaughan. She did a whole album of Mancini's music. Yeah, have you heard it?
No,
Oh, so
I'm
good. It's
very, very
Sarah
curious about
Vaughan.
this.
Yes, Sarah Vaughan sings the Mancini songbook on Mercury Records, came out in 1965. She recorded How Soon, Days of Wine and Roses, Dear Heart, Charade, Too Little Time, Dreamsville, Peter Gunn, Moon River, I Love You and Don't You Forget It, Slow Hot Wind, which is what we're going to listen to, Mr. Lucky, so swinging, and It Had Better Be Tonight with the Johnny Mercer lyric, who often collaborated with Mancini. I just love this melody and the Norman Gimbel lyric that was added to it. It is called Slow Hot Wind, or Lujan is the other name of the piece. David Benoit was chiming in earlier on our post saying he loved this tune. It's also known by that track Lujan, and it's featured in the movie The Big Lebowski, when he goes to meet Jackie Treehorn. Ben Gazzara plays Jackie Treehorn on the beach in Malibu at his really cool house, and I just love that. And it's such a, to me, Mancini's music is so California, even though he was from Cleveland and he spent some time in Pennsylvania, grew up in Pennsylvania. There's something very uniquely LA and relaxing, and just even the title, Slow Hot Wind. And then when you hear Sarah Vaughan's, as usual, ridiculous phrasing and delivery of this melody, I think you'll fall in love with the song all over again.
I'm very curious.
Yeah, the whole
You've
record's great.
warmed me up pretty
Okay.
good.
All right. And that's from 65, did I say? Yeah, 1965. Slow Hot Wind by Henry Mancini, produced by Quincy Jones. And the arrangers are Bill Holman. I'm not sure who arranged this track, but it was Bill Holman, Billy Byers, Bob James, I think, arranged a tune or two. It's kind of a smorgasbord of ridiculously talented people on this
Couldn't
album.
get anybody good.
Yeah, I might be leaving an arranger off, but I'm not sure who arranged this one. Maybe we can figure it out, or maybe Dick Nash knows. You never
You never
know.
know.
All
The
right, Sarah
all-knowing
Vaughan.
Dick Nash.
Yes. Sarah Vaughan singing Henry Mancini's Slow Hot Wind with Norman Gimbel's lyrics.
Slow, hot wind.
just waiting. Some days it's too warm to fight a slow.
Tracks on that record, but it just transports me to this mid-60s, you know, sitting on a beach with a cocktail and as the sun goes down, feeling. Sarah Vaughan, 1965 on Mercury Records. Sarah sings the Mancini songbook, and I highly encourage everyone check that one out. I mean, Dreamsville is great. Mr. Lucky's super swinging.
Yeah.
Days of Wine and Roses. I mean, she sings, and some lesser known ones on there as well. And of course, the great Quincy Jones producing, can't go wrong with that talent. And Sarah doesn't, you know, do too much with that melody. I think you don't need to. It's so beautifully, perfectly crafted by Mancini. She just brings out her little Sarah-isms here and there, and a very sparse orchestration. You know, there's no strings on that get real big or anything. It really just kind of simmers the whole time.
Yeah. The music just does the work by itself.
Right.
Very much so. The rhythm section also is, I mean, I have to give credit to that, to Peter Erskine.
Nah.
Cause I was, we were listening to, I forgot which record it was, but it was a Keith Jarrett record with Paul Motion, and Motion just plays a certain groove up until like 6 minutes into the recording, and then changes to a different groove or a different thing. And he said to me, you know, like, well, Motion didn't do anything, you know, except that groove for the full 6 minutes, because the music does the work by itself. So I have to give credit to Peter for that quote.
Oh,
for
yes.
Sure.
Master, talking about other masters.
yeah, most definitely.
That's a good quote. Yeah.
Yeah, and Tom Kubas is here too.
Tom.
Hey Tom. If
recent
it's Mancini,
guest.
It's an alto flute. Yep, that's for sure true.
we had such a ball with you, Tom. My goodness. If you guys missed it, make sure you go to our Kevin's YouTube page. You'll find the Tom Kubas interview. It was just a hoot.
Not up yet, but it will be soon.
Oh,
yes. But
shame. Put it
I
up
have
there.
To do my homework. Shame on me. What is he? He's saying something. I think the most fascinating thing that blows me away is that you can play music out of a real book or any book, and it's kind of okay. Or you play a Mancini tune out of a book, and the notes literally reach out and speak
yes.
to you. Well said.
Yeah, Tom, I couldn't agree more. In fact, I remember the first time I read Days of Wine and Roses out of a real book. I didn't know any better, you know. Let's read it out of a real book, not learn the tune off a record. I surely learned that I should do it the other way. However, real books are helpful. But I thought that as well. And then another tune was the that I thought that. I read it. It was Lovers in New York, which is the secondary kind of theme in Breakfast at Tiffany's. And it just what you just said in that, Tom, the melody just kind of leaps out no matter what you do, however you play it. It sings and sparkles in a different way. He really had that really natural knack for writing melodies and interesting harmony too. I mean, that one has some really cool changes. Lovers in New York. Yeah, it's got it.
Yeah.
It's very hip. Yeah.
I didn't plan on playing this, but it was a track that we talked about yesterday, actually, A Shot in the Dark. And I've been listening. I've had this album on rewind.
Oh,
it's Shirley Scott, who is a great Hammond player.
Great.
I think she is also a great singer. Not completely sure, but she plays. It's her album. Yeah. And one side of the, I have the vinyl here too. One side of the vinyl is her with a big band, with Oliver Nelson arrangements, and the
Ooh.
other side is a trio recording with Bob Crenshaw on bass and Otis Finch, really, really great drummer. And the first side is with a full big band, and they play A Shot in the Dark, which is a Henry Mancini composition from a movie you said, right? Is it
Yeah,
a movie title?
it's I believe it's the I think it's number two in the Pink Panther series. I might be wrong about
Ah.
that, but it is Peter Sellers. And we watch, I have a little film club with Karen Hammack, who's here. And that was part of our Peter Sellers watch, The Party as well, but Shot in the Dark. Yep, Mancini score. George Sanders is in that and some other fun actors. Yeah.
Yeah, it goes to show that the works of Mancini have been widely covered. Lots of songs that that he made were, you know, rearranged or recut. I know that Meldow has a version of Dreamsville
Dreamsville.
of one of his live albums.
Right.
This version took me really by the throat, and also because of the arranging, masterful arranging of Oliver Nelson. So I would like to show you A Shot in the Dark by Oliver Nelson with Shirley Scott on organ. Here we go. So good.
Yeah.
So good. I've had that album on repeat for a couple of days because Oliver Nelson's writing on this album is so good and surely plays her
Yeah.
ass off.
I don't know it. I'm gonna get it. Great Scott is the name of the record.
Great Scott, yes.
Great Scott. Wow.
On
Funky.
Impulse.
And I love her organ sound on that. Oh, thanks for sharing that. It's nice to see how it's been covered and not just always play, you know, his music, not just play his recordings, but how other people have interpreted some Mancini throughout the years. Mm-hmm. That's really great.
Most definitely, yeah.
And it's, you know, it's that Pink Panther bluesy melody, but he gets so much mileage out of it because it's just such a strong sell of an idea. And yes, it was originally written for a motion picture. However, it lives outside of it. And that's what I love about his music, is that it's just so solid, no matter, you know, how it's happening or where it's happening.
Yeah. And you can say about the same thing about Peter Gunn, too. There have been countless jazz versions of Peter Gunn. I have the jazz version of Peter Gunn from Shelley
oh,
Mann.
Yeah. That's
Excuse
great.
Me. That's some really great iteration of Peter Gunn's music. Ted Nash actually has brother of Dick Nash has made his own version of Peter Gunn's music.
Wow.
I just discovered an album that's called Music from Peter Gunn by the Aaron Bell Orchestra, and Aaron Bell was the bass player for Duke Ellington for a number of years.
This one.
Yeah, there
yeah.
you go.
Yeah,
I'm
this
looking.
Is pretty killing, actually. Yeah, Aaron Bell, right?
Who plays on that recording? Can you?
Well,
does it say?
It doesn't say, and I haven't looked into this one yet, so I'll get back to you on that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now I'm jealous that you have that one.
That was grandfather's. Yeah, my grandpa had that one. Like I said, he had a number of, well, maybe two or three, but that one was in the collection. So.
Yeah.
We'll look into it. Yeah.
Now that I'm thinking about it, Shelley made a bunch of versions. Like, he made the music of Peter Gunn, but then the vinyl that I have over here is called Jazz Gunn.
Oh.
Which is a different version also.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so
Jazz Gunn.
Jazz Gunn, a jazz version of Peter Gunn's music, and lots of improvisation stuff in that band too. Conti Condoli is on trumpet on that one. I believe it's Russ Freeman, Monty Budwick, and Richie Kamuka, but I'm not completely sure.
Right.
Don't quote me on that. But Shelley. So Shelley is one of the greatest drummers that I've ever heard in my life. Absolutely.
Oh, yes.
Such a creative force, and just such a great imagination that guy had for his orchestrations and improvisations and the touch that he had on the instrument. And oh, I could go on and on about Shelley. Peter is still the greatest fan of Shelley Mann, but I'm right behind him.
Nice. Well, while we have, hopefully Mr. Nash is still with us, Henry Mancini's favorite trombonist.
Yeah, I believe so.
Is he still here? Hey, Dick,
yeah,
we're going to play your feature. Would love to share that with everyone. Maybe some folks have already heard it. It's from the 1954 film, The Glenn Miller Story, starring Jimmy Stewart, yet another Jimmy Stewart vehicle we're talking about here, with June Allison. It's just a beautiful composition. Mancini, of course, scored the film. And this is the great Dick Nash, who is waiting in the wings here on Zoom and been sending us some comments, and just
he's still here. He's saying it right now.
Oh, great. Great. All the best to you guys out there. And so here's Dick on Too Little Time. Too Little Time.
Thank you.
Isn't that beautiful?
Ooh.
Wow. Yeah, Mr. Nash.
Just yeah.
Rip my heart out.
Yeah.
And he says, Vince. I guess you mean Vince DeRosa.
Yeah.
Yeah, the great, great French horn player.
Yep.
Wow.
Still with us also, 100
yes.
years old.
My goodness. That just, I just love it. And what a great film, if you haven't seen it. What was I gonna say? I was looking at Mancini's. I have to share the screen. I mean, anyone can look at this on their own time, but just while we're all here together, just in the year alone, 1954. Look at this. Glenn Miller's story was his first, but then look at all these movies he did in 1 year, uncredited apparently.
Yeah.
So many I haven't seen. Of course, I've seen Creature from the Black Lagoon, which is a very famous thriller. He also did It Came from Outer Space and The Creature Walks Among Us. But just incredible. So good times.
Yeah, that's cool.
What a busy guy. He was working so much. I mean, if you just look at all the movies that he did. Look at this. We're not even at his 50s yet.
Yeah.
Look at that. Now we get to the 60s, and then we start to see Experiment in Terror. Here's Breakfast at Tiffany's, Andy White, Mr. Hobbs, Days of Wine and Roses. Of course, more of his well-known things were happening in the 60s. Pink Panther, Shot in the Dark.
Yeah.
The Great Race. Anyway, just incredibly prolific, you know.
Yeah.
Something else.
Yeah, yeah. I think we maybe should finish it going out with a bang.
Let's do it.
Because we've heard a lot of beautiful, lush melodies,
yes, we have.
Lush string arrangements and all of that stuff. There's a tune that's kind of like, you know, nice and majestic off of Uniquely Mancini, which might be one of the lesser known tunes that's on that recording. And I'm talking about Banzai Pipeline, which is a very hard swinging tune off of this recording. And I think it's an original composition by Mancini. You can correct me if I'm wrong, Josh. It's just a nice combination of original compositions on this recording, mixed with a couple of really cool standards in it. So
It's written by him. It says on
okay.
Here. Yeah.
Cool. Well, to finish out our 1 year anniversary episodes, let's enjoy and go out with a bang. Cheers, everybody.
Cheers, everybody. Thanks for joining us.
I certainly hope that you had a drink for our nice Mancini cocktail hour. I did, for sure.
What was your drink? Why don't you tell all the viewers? It looked really cool.
Yes, I can. So if you don't know, I am a pretty avid fan of mixology, and I'm always on the lookout for nice recipes. And this, what I was drinking, is what you call a Blackbird, and it has coffee liqueur in it. It's about 0.75 ounces of coffee liqueur, and it has 2 ounces of pineapple juice in it. I have to an ounce of Jamaican rum in it, half an ounce of lime juice, and a quarter ounce of simple syrup. And sorry, I shouldn't forget, half an ounce of Campari. So it's a lot of different. There's a lot going on, but it's very, very tasty.
Yeah.
Very, very tasty.
And a nice color. Called,
most definitely. It's a tiki cocktail.
Yeah,
it's a very cool tiki cocktail. Very, you know, like it's a pretty good weather outside. It's getting warmer, so it's a good drink to cool off with, for sure. That being said, without further ado, let's enjoy Banzai Pipeline by Henry Mancini. This is cheers. My apologies. That's a different one. Here we go. False start. Banzai Pipeline. with some fireworks of the great Jack Sperling
Oh, wow.
at the end. Yeah.
Jack. Wow. That's such a
Yeah.
burning track. Plas Johnson on tenor. Yeah.
Yeah,
Wow.
nice, cool shuffle in that repertoire on that recording.
And
So,
probably Peter Conti on the solo, maybe, huh?
yes,
Sounded like
I,
Pete,
yeah,
maybe.
yeah. Pete was more of the lead trumpet and the high register guy, and Conti was more in the style of Chet and those guys. So yeah, that's a good guess that it's Pete.
Maybe Dick will correct me.
Yeah. He
That's
said that he's going
slinging.
to take 12 ounces of
Ah, I
Sam
love
Adams
it.
after this.
Yeah, that'll leave you with less of a hanger that over than Kevin's gonna have.
Oh boy. Oh boy.
Yeah. This is a little bit of Japanese whiskey that I've been sipping on today. So don't need much of a recipe for that. But I am like Kevin, I do like mixing drinks and doing the same thing. But yeah. Man, that was swinging. Nice call.
Yeah.
Uniquely Mancini is such a good record.
Yeah.
And
Yeah.
I just makes me we've talked about Sperling, Jack Sperling, the great drummer before, and just takes me back to getting to play with him, maybe 10 times when I was 18 years old and how I didn't know who he was. And now I'm kicking myself for not, talking to him. He was
Yeah.
in his later years in the late 1990s when I played with him, but he could still swing back then, man. And
Oh, I'm sure.
yeah, he's just a force, and he's really killing it on that track.
Yeah.
And I see that Al Schmidt, at least on Discogs, the great engineer who just passed away just a couple weeks ago, he maybe co-produced this record too. I don't know if that's true, if we can believe it, but rest in peace to one of the most prolific engineers and a wonderful man, Al
Yeah,
Schmidt, who just passed
absolutely.
on. We already mentioned him, but might as well mention again because he has recorded so much of this music that we've been looking at, not only today with Mancini, but many other artists over the years. So,
Most definitely.
yeah.
Well, on that note,
Wow, we've gone almost
next
2 hours.
week we
That
almost are at 2 hours. That's how
was
fast it goes. It's incredible.
a fun one. We could have kept going. There's so much Mancini. Wow.
That's true. For next week, everybody who's watching and listening, for next week we're going to have the great Bill Cunliffe as our special guest. Great band leader, composer, arranger, and piano player. He has worked with people such as Buddy Rich, Frank Sinatra, Woody Shaw. I know he was also a member of the Clayton Hamilton Jazz Orchestra in the early days of that big band. So we're really looking forward to Bill, who's a prolific composer and arranger, Grammy Award winning and Grammy nominated as well. The medley that he wrote for the West Side Story, that was the one that won the Grammy, if I'm not mistaken.
Correct.
Yep. So that should be fun to talk and hang and listen to some music of the great Mr. Bill Conliff. So tune in next week, because we'll be back next week with another episode. And for everybody who's hung around, thank you guys so much for joining us today for our 1 year anniversary episode with the music of the great Henry Mancini. Special thank you to Mr. Dick Nash for hanging with us and giving us all the nice trivia. Thank you, Dick, once again. And thank you to co-host Josh Nelson for doing this with me for this past year, because it's been an unbelievable experience to talk about this music and hang with all of the guests that we've had so far and will come for sure. We'll see everybody next week.
Thanks everyone, and thanks Kevin. Great work picking the tracks, and yeah, just a pleasure. Thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
All
Thank
right.
you.
See you guys next week. Thanks for being here.
See you next week, everybody.